Hey guys, welcome back to my channel, The ENT Resident. Today, the topic of discussion is going to be about sigmoid sinus thrombosis. You can also purchase my notes now. I have added links in the description. Okay, so let's get started with sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Why is this important for an ENT surgeon to know about this topic? That is because this is a very common topic asked in your theories as well as in practicals if you get a case of CSOM, because this is one of the intracranial complications of chronic suppurative otitis media. So we have to know what all symptoms and signs we should look out for in a complicated case of CSOM. Let's get started with knowing what is sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Now, sigmoid sinus thrombosis is an inflammation of the inner wall of the lateral venous sinus or the sigmoid sinus with formation of an intrasinus thrombus. So there is first an inflammation of the inner wall of the sinus with the formation of an intrasinus thrombus. Now, sigmoid sinus thrombosis is also known by other names like lateral sinus thrombophlebitis, otogenic suppurative thrombophlebitis. Now, what is the cause of sigmoid sinus thrombosis? This is usually seen occurring as a complication of acute coalescent mastoiditis, masked mastoiditis, and cholesteatoma. This is an intracranial complication of all of these conditions mentioned here. Now, let's look into what are the stages that we see in the pathology of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. So there are four stages in the pathology of this disease. Let's discuss each one of them. So how does it begin? So first stage is the formation of a perisinus abscess. Now, if you see in the image over here, the first part, you can see the first thing that happens is there is an abscess formation related to the outer dural wall of the sinus. So first, the outer dural wall starts getting inflamed and there is an abscess formation happening here. The overlying bony dural plate may have been destroyed if this is a case of cholesteatoma. Sometimes the bony dural plate can remain intact when the route of infection has been by thrombophlebitis. So the first stage is basically inflammation of the outer dural wall of the sinus and formation of an abscess in relation to this wall. Coming to the next stage is endophlebitis and mural thrombus formation. Now, the inflammation has now started spreading to involve the inner wall of the venous sinus. So, if you see in the second image over here, the inner wall has started to get involved and now there is a deposition of fibrin, platelets and blood cells happening over here, which ultimately leads to the formation of a thrombus inside the sinus. So you can see in the image over here, this is the intrasinus thrombus formation happening inside. So the second stage is where there is inflammation of the inner wall and a thrombus formation. Next, we come to the third stage. Now, the third stage is the stage where there is obliteration of the sinus lumen and intrasinus abscess formation. So, the mural thrombus that has formed in the previous stage starts expanding now. Now, as it expands, it starts to occlude the sinus lumen completely. So, now that it has occluded the sinus lumen completely, now the microorganisms start to invade this thrombus, leading to the formation of an intrasinus abscess. Now, this abscess will now start to release infected emboli into the bloodstream, leading to the development of septicemia. You can see in the image here that there is a central abscess formation in the third image over here. Now, this abscess formation has happened because microorganisms have invaded the thrombus. Now, this is releasing septic emboli and leading to the development of septicemia. Coming off to the last stage in the pathology of this disease is the extension of the thrombus. Now that the thrombus formation has already occurred, it starts to extend distally as well as proximally. So if it goes proximally, it can spread to involve the confluence of sinuses, and it can involve the superior sagittal sinus or the cavernous sinus, leading to further complications. And if it extends distally, it can involve the mastoid emissary vein, the jugular bulb, or even the jugular vein. So these are the four stages of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. The first stage is where there is a inflammation of the outer dural wall and formation of perisinus abscess. Next stage is the endophlebitis, where there is inflammation of the inner wall and a mural thrombus formation. Third stage is when this mural thrombus starts to expand and obliterates the sinus lumen and leads to the formation of an intrasinus abscess. And last stage is when there is extension of this thrombus proximally as well as distally to involve other structures. Now, what are the important microorganisms that we have seen in connection to this? So if it has happened as a result of, as a complication of acute otitis media, in that case, the organisms seen are hemolytic streptococcus, pneumococcus, and staphylococcus. Whereas if it has happened as a complication of cholesteatoma, in that case, the organisms seen are Bacillus proteus, Pseudomonas pyocyanus, Escherichia coli, and Staphylococcus. Now let's learn about what are the clinical features you'll be seeing in this patient. So there are multiple signs that you need to remember in relation to sigmoid sinus thrombosis. I'll be discussing them now. So whenever a patient comes to you with high-grade fever, a toxic look on the face, a complaint of deep ear pain, restlessness, neck stiffness, and papilledema, these are all typical features that will point you towards the diagnosis of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Now let's discuss each feature one by one. Coming to fever. Now the fever that we see in sigmoid sinus thrombosis is a very specific type of fever, which is known as picket fence type of fever with rigor. Now what is picket fence and why is it called picket fence? So if you see the image over here, this is what a picket fence is. And you can see how the fence goes down like this, and then again it goes up, rises up, and again it goes down. So this pattern repeats. So this is the pattern of fever that we see in sigmoid sinus thrombosis, where the fever is irregular and it will have one or more such peaks in the day. And why is this peak of that peak that we see over here, the picket fence peak that we are seeing, that is happening because of septicemia, which coincides with the release of septic emboli into the bloodstream. We studied in the third stage of pathology that after the formation of an intrasinus abscess, when the microorganisms have invaded the thrombus, this leads to the release of septic emboli into the bloodstream. And that leads to the development of this typical feature of fever over here, which is known as picket fence type of fever. So the fever we see is very irregular and is usually accompanied by chills and rigor. And once there is a fall of temperature, just before that, it is accompanied by profuse sweating. So this clinical picture that we are seeing over here resembles malaria. But the difference is the fact that it lacks the regularity that we see in a case of malaria. And in between bouts of fever, you'll see that the patient becomes completely okay. They are alert with a sense of well-being. This typical presentation that we have seen here can not be seen as well in case the patient has started receiving antibiotics early. In that case, they will not show this typical presentation of a picket fence type of fever with chill and rigor. Next feature is headache. Now, in early stages, the headache can be due to the formation of the perisinus abscess. In this case, the headache will be very mild. But later, when it becomes very severe, intracranial pressure starts to rise due to venous obstruction. In this case, the headache will be very severe. Thirdly, we'll see a progressive anemia and emaciation in the patient. And this happens because of the beta-hemolytic streptococcus involvement. Next thing that we need to know is a sign, and this sign is known as Grissinger's sign. Now, this is a common PG entrance exam question that you can get in your NEET PG. This can also come as a Viva question. Now, if you see in the image over here, this image is shown to you and it is asked to you, what disease is this? What sign is this? So what we see here is a tenderness and edema over the posterior part of the mastoid. And this usually occurs due to the thrombosis of mastoid emissary vein. Now, Grissinger's sign is a typical feature of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Next feature is papilledema. A papilledema is often seen when the right-sided sigmoid sinus gets thrombosed or when the clot extends to involve the superior sagittal sinus. What will we see here when we do a fundoscopy? We'll be seeing blurring of disc margins, retinal hemorrhages, or dilated veins. Fundus changes may be absent only when the collateral circulation is very good. So papilledema is a feature that you will see much later when the disease has progressed more to involve other sinus. Next is, there will be tenderness seen along the jugular vein. This will be seen when the thrombophlebitis process has extended distally to involve the jugular vein as well. In that case, you may have an associated enlargement and inflammation of the jugular chain of lymph nodes and torticollis as well. So these are some of the features that you will see. There are also a few tests that you can perform. There are two such tests that you need to know. And again, this is very important from the perspective of NEET PG as well. This is a very common question asked. So the first test is the Toby Ayer test or the Quicken Sense test. Now, what do we do here? Here, we are basically recording the CSF pressure with the help of a manometer. And what we are seeing here, we are seeing what is the effect of manual compression of one or both of the jugular veins. So what we do with the help of your finger, you press the jugular vein on one side. So if you have compressed the vein on the thrombus side, usually there will be no change seen in the manometer in the CSF pressure. But if you compress the vein on the healthy side, you will see that there is a rapid rise in CSF pressure, which will be equal to bilateral compression of jugular veins. So this is known as the Toby Ayer test. Second test is the Croix-Beck test. Here we will be performing ophthalmoscopy and we will be looking at the retinal veins. So when you press the jugular vein of the healthy side, it should be producing engorgement of the retinal veins and the supraorbital veins. And this engorgement will immediately subside when you release the pressure. So this is the Croix-Beck test. So this is happening on the healthy side. If you perform it on the diseased side or the thrombus side, this engorgement will not be seen. So this is all about the clinical features and two tests that you can do in relation to sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Now let's learn about how will we investigate this case. So first of all, we perform a peripheral blood smear, and this is because I have said the clinical picture has a resemblance to malaria. So an absence of malarial parasite in the peripheral blood smear will rule out malaria as a differential diagnosis. Second, we'll perform a blood culture. Why do we perform it? We are doing it to find out what is a causative organism here, and this will help you in guiding your treatment when you are giving intravenous antibiotics. Now, when should you take the blood for culture? It should be taken only at the time of chills. This is because this is the time when the organisms enter the bloodstream. Sometimes even repeated cultures may be required to identify the organism. Third, we'll perform a lumbar puncture and examine the CSF. Now, CSF examination is mostly normal over here, except for a rise in the pressure. This will also help to rule out meningitis. Next is X-ray mastoid. Now, X-ray mastoid will show you clouding of air cells just like in mastoiditis, or if there is a cholesteatoma, there will be evidence of bone destruction. Next, we move on to performing more important investigations, and that is a contrast-enhanced CT scan. What will we see here? Now, again, a typical sign in relation to this is the delta sign. If you see in the image over here, this is the delta sign over here. How do we describe it? We can see that it is a triangular area with a rim enhancement and a central low density. This we'll see in the posterior cranial fossa only on axial cuts. So this is the typical sign that we are seeing in this. Next, MRI. MRI will be more sensitive than CT scan. You can see delta sign even on an MRI. So on MRI, it will show a blood flow, sinus obstruction, and then subsequent reversal of the flow. When we perform a gadolinium-enhanced MRI, the thrombus will appear as a soft tissue signal associated with a vascular and bright appearance of the dural walls. MR venography is used to assess progression or resolution of the thrombus. So these are all the investigations that you need to perform. Now let's move on to how will we treat a case of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. First of all is to give intravenous antibiotics. Usually third generation cephalosporins are given, but you can also decide with the help of culture sensitivity report which antibiotic would be best in your particular case, and it is usually continued for at least a week after the operation. Next, mastoidectomy and exposure of sinus. Now, a complete cortical or modified radical or radical mastoidectomy is performed depending on whether the sinus thrombosis has complicated an acute medullary disease or a chronic medullary disease. Sinus bony plate is removed to expose the dura, and then you end up draining the perisinus abscess. When you find an infected clot or an intrasinus abscess, it is also drained. Now, usually in these cases, it's seen that the sinus dura is already destroyed, or it can be unhealthy and discolored with granulation. In that case, we'll incise the dura and then we'll drain the infected clot and abscess. But before you put an incision in the dura, the sinus should be packed above and below by inserting a pack between the bone and dura of the sinus to control the bleeding. If you see any healthy red clot formation beyond the abscess at either end of the sinus, definitely do not disturb that. Then the pack that you have put is usually replaced 5 to 6 days post-operatively, and then the wound is secondarily closed. So this is the main surgical treatment over here, which is mastoidectomy and exposure of sinus and draining of the abscess and removing of the clot. There are some other modalities like ligation of internal jugular vein. This is rarely required nowadays. Some indications of performing this surgery is when the antibiotic and surgical treatment have failed to control embolic phenomena and rigors. When there is tenderness and swelling along the jugular vein, it is spreading. There is a deterioration in the general condition of the patient and evidence of clot extending below the mastoid. Next is anticoagulant therapy. Again, this is not required nowadays. It is only used when thrombus is extending to involve the cavernous sinus as well. And contraindications to anticoagulant therapy are hypothrombinemia, history of an active peptic ulcer, active pulmonary tuberculosis, and a recent stroke history. Now, what is the dosage used in anticoagulant therapy? So we'll administer heparin with a bolus dose of 5,000 to 10,000 international units, followed by a continuous infusion of 1,000 to 1,500 IU per hour. Now, the rate of infusion is adjusted such that APTT is twice the control value. This is given for a period of 7 to 10 days and patient should be monitored for thrombocytopenia. And before you start the anticoagulant therapy, you should definitely start the patient on a high dose of systemic antibiotics so as to prevent septicemia. Last of all, there's some supportive treatment like repeated blood transfusions may be required to combat the anemia that the patient faces and improve their resistance. So that's all about the treatment of sigmoid sinus thrombosis. Next, let's discuss what are the complications of such a case. It can lead to septicemia. It can have pyemic abscesses in the lung, bone, joints, or subcutaneous tissue. Other intracranial complications like meningitis, subdural abscess, cerebellar abscess. If it involves the jugular bulb and jugular vein, it can involve the 9th, 10th, and 11th cranial nerve, which is present in the jugular foramen. There can be a cavernous sinus thrombosis and otitic hydrocephalus when the thrombus extends to the sagittal sinus via the confluence of sinuses. Last of all is differential diagnosis of such a case. First one is obviously malaria because of its resemblance in the fever pattern. Other than that, there's malaria, tuberculosis, miliary tuberculosis, typhus, brucellosis, and viral pneumonia. So that's all about sigmoid sinus thrombosis, also known as lateral sinus thrombophlebitis. If you have any questions regarding this, please note them down in the comment section and I'll get back to you. Thank you.